Hey, this is YBR with BeamNG Drive, and today we're going to be taking a look at a mod called the RG Apex XCR. As you can see, there are four versions available. We got the Turbo V8 Racer, the V8, the Inline 6, and the Inline 6 Cup. We're going to be starting with the Inline 6 because that's the basest version of the vehicle. It always feels weird to me when you call a dedicated race car the base version, but that is what this is. And you can see it's not a super detailed vehicle, but the body style does match its purpose, which is to be a dedicated track car. And it's pretty good at doing just that. So to test things off, let's go to the right, which is a tighter area of Hirochi Raceway that I don't use that often. But this car feels really good in this area because it's the inline six. It doesn't have a ton of power like the V8 version, but it has a good amount of power for going through this area. And it has a ton of grip. I would say this thing has so much grip, it's probably unrealistic. But it does drive really nicely because of that. Now, believe it or not, this version actually only has semi-slick tires, and the later versions that we'll be showing off have full-on racing slicks that grip even better. But as you see, we're going through these corners pretty fast. Like this one right here, we're going about 50 miles per hour without much trouble. And I'm just gonna drive wherever. I have absolutely no idea where I'm going. We're just gonna see where the road takes me. In fact, for a second, I didn't even know where I was. But now I do because I recognize that corner. And now I don't because I never go this way. So he knew where he was for about 5 seconds, and now we're just gonna drive along the road and see where it takes me. If I could stay on the road, I did go a little bit off of it. But yeah, this is a really nice car to drive. Tons of grip, not too much power, pretty easy to stay in control of it. It really feels like it would be an ideal track car for the beginner with a ton of money who can go out and afford a brand new car just for driving on the track. Unlike us normal human beings who would go and buy a car for a couple $1,000, throw a roll cage in it, and be like, okay, let's go to the track. Although I should point out, this version of the vehicle does not have a roll cage, which does negatively affect the safety a lot, which I'll show you the next time I see a good straightaway to crash it. But right now, we got corners, we're gonna execute the corners, and once again, I actually know where I am, so there should be a nice long straightaway coming up in a second. But until then, we have a little bit more driving we're gonna be doing. Well, maybe not that much, because this is the last corner we're actually gonna be going around properly. The next corner, we're not going to go around it at all. We're going to go straight through it into the wall, and we're going to wreck this thing up, and you will see just how easy it is to wreck this thing. So we're going to be going about 90 miles per hour on impact, straight into this wall, 8x slow-mo, and yeah, it crumples hard. And if there was a driver in it, he's done for. It might be safer to be ejected from the car in this situation. This thing got crushed so bad. And it doesn't seem like it can drive anymore, so we'll go ahead and reset it. And then we're going to swap it out for a different version of the vehicle. We're going to go with the Inline 6 Cup, which is really similar to the Inline 6 we were just driving, with two small changes. First, you have the addition of a roll cage. Second, you have the addition of a big rear wing, which makes the vehicle look a lot faster, but it's really not much faster than when we were just driving because all that extra stuff does add weight to it. But then it also adds downforce, so it just makes it a little bit better in the corners, but a little bit worse on the straight. So depending on the track, it might be faster or it might be slower. There's really no, this one's better than the other one, unless you're speaking in terms of safety, where the roll cage actually does reinforce the driver's compartment to make it safer. But still, this is not a vehicle that I want to be in a crash in. As you will see shortly, we're going to try to do this crash at about the same speed. So we want to go around 90 miles per hour into the wall. So we're up to 90 right now. We can kind of slow down a bit. And there is the wall. Gonna go 8x slow-mo once again. So 93 is pretty close to 90. And you see right here, the driver's compartment does hold up a little bit more, but now the engine is kind of taking a peek in there, saying, hey, what you doing in there? And actually, look at this. It can still drive. This is one of those cars where the drive shaft can never break. So you can always put power down to the rear wheels, no matter what, which is completely unrealistic, but it is fun when you get something dumb like this. We have a car where the wheelbase is like 2 feet. And yet it somehow still drives, except you really can't control it because you got no steering of sorts because the whole front suspension has been destroyed to bits. And it's also kind of funny that the wing somehow held onto that. I'm pretty sure the wing can actually fall off though, can't it? Let's do a quick little check here. Yes, the wing can fall off. It just held on somehow. Now it's bouncing all over the place because I tore it off with such force. Anyways, we can't do anything more with this, so let's just go ahead and reset it. And we'll try doing a crash a little bit slower than 90 miles per hour. So let's just do one right into this wall. It's going to be about 50 to 60 miles per hour, it looks like. So again, 8x slow-mo. And there we go. You can see the wheelbase did shrink right there. And the car kind of shook from the crash. Let's see. Can it still drive, though? Yes, it can. And I do have steering, although it is pulling to the left. But we have a long sweeping left corner right here. So all I need to do is just tap to go to the right a little bit and we can actually stay on this thing pretty well without doing much at all. Like, I did do a little bit of left steering there, but it did a lot of the work all on its own, which is kind of fun. So it's fully drivable now. Why don't we do another crash at about the same speed? We just gotta find the right opportunity to do it. I think coming out of this corner right to that wall should be good. So there's about a 50 mile per hour crash. That one looked a little bit more brutal than the other one, didn't it? We still have steering, but the wheels are not really on the ground, so we're bouncing all over the place, so I can't really control it too well. But we can drive a little bit. Oh, the right front wheel has actually lost steering, and I can't do much in that situation because it's kind of pointed in the completely wrong direction most of the time, and I'm just bouncing too much to control it. Anyways, a quick look at the vehicle. Again, the engine is peeking into the cabin saying, "Hey, driver, what you doing?" Resetting the vehicle, that's what. And one of the funny things about this vehicle is even though it has a modeled engine, there's actually no normal, realistic way to take a look at it. The only way you actually can see the engine is if you poke your head through the vehicle or if the engine peeks its way out of the vehicle. So to demonstrate this, I'm bringing this car up to about 80 miles per hour, freeze physics, go to fun stuff, and let's do a break all brake groups and put this thing to 16 times almost so we can enjoy the parts falling off right here. So full speed ahead, first to go is the wing, making all this downforce to pull it off. And then slowly you see the body panels just saying, "Wait a minute, I don't have to stay attached anymore." The wheels are going a little bit faster. And now we'll go ahead and speed things up to 8x slow-mo. And then how about we say full speed now? Huh, that's kind of interesting. Wait, does the right rear wheel not have a brake on it? I'll check that out later on a fresh car, but I was saying, all the body panels have fallen off, but there's still no visible way to see the engine. You can't see it from above or from below. The only way you'll see it is if you actually pull your camera into the engine area, and then you can kind of get an idea what the engine looks like, but it is pretty hard to get a clear view on it because you're trying to actually stick your head through a body panel of the vehicle. Now let's take a look at that brake I was curious about. Because when I hit break all brake groups, I did not see the brake in the right rear wheel, and I still don't think I see one. Oh, for sure, there is not one there. It is clear as day there is one on that wheel. And there's one on that front wheel, and there is one on that wheel. This wheel, though, there for some reason is not a brake. Makes me curious, though. Does that mean the car doesn't brake in a straight line if you slam on the brakes? So let's see, about 60 miles per hour and slamming on them. Now, that stays nice and straight when you hit the brakes, so it's just visually not there. It still drives normal. And one thing that's kind of funny about this car I just kind of noticed is it almost looks like it has active aero when you're braking because the lights light up and the rear end lifts up a little bit, so it looks like it has some sort of fancy active aero, but it's not. It's just when you brake really hard, the car lifts its rear, which means the front probably dips down a little bit, right? Let's see. So looking at the front, yeah, the front dips some. So it's not like it's a super duper stiff suspension setup, because super duper stiff ones, you wouldn't be able to see the dip that clearly. Although it still has a pretty stiff suspension setup because it is made for track duty, and it does that really well. Really, really well. I have a feeling though, it's not very durable if you hit it the wrong way. So if we like just tap the wall with our wheel, oh, yep, I got no steering. That right there just killed the steering in the car. See, I'm going left and right here, not doing nothing. So you gotta be careful about hitting the wheels of the vehicle on the walls like that. So let's go ahead and level up the car to the V8 version, which has this crazy, almost gold looking color on it that I think is perfect for a track car because everybody will see you and notice, stay out your way because you're the crazy idiot who has the brightly colored car. I also like how the wing actually gets the color too, just a little bit on the tips. And I really like that because it makes the wing blend in with the car so much better than just being a plain wing that almost looks like it was an aftermarket edition. And I am sliding all over the place right here with all this extra V8 power, but it's still relatively easy to keep the vehicle under control. It's just now you're a lot more likely to go sliding around a corner when you try to put the power down because you have so much more power. It's not like the inline six where you could just float around the corners and be fine. You float around these ones, you get a little bit sideways, like I did right there, but the steering on this car and the grip of this car is so good that getting a little bit sideways is not concerning. You can get really sideways and still spin out, sure, but we're not going super steep like we're trying to drift or nothing. It's just getting on the power a little too fast, a little too hard, which kicks the back end out. So I think we'll go ahead and finish up a lap with this thing before we crash it because we're already almost done. We have basically one more corner in the S-curves right here. And this is my favorite part of the track, to be honest with you. I love going through that section because you feel like you're going fast no matter what because of the way you can hit those corners like that. So I'm gonna go full speed on this straight and then we'll try to crash into a wall. This won't be a direct hit like the other crashes we were doing earlier, so I'm not sure if it'll do more or less damage. We're gonna be going a bit over 100 miles per hour and then kind of dive into the wall. Yeah, okay, we really bounced off the wall, so it actually wasn't that much damage. And can we drive? And no, I got no steering at all, unfortunately. We can take a look at the damage real quickly before we go ahead and reset it. And I think it's time to show off the fastest version of the vehicle now. We're going to go with the Turbo V8 Racer, which even has a warning on it. None of the other vehicles even have a description. This one's so crazy, it has a warning. This setup is difficult to drive. Be sure to add electronic stability control if it is too difficult for you. Does YBR need electronic stability control? Let's find out. We're going to start by flooring it right here. And also, I think all of the cars actually have the same gearing to them, just different engines. So top speed isn't affected. It's just you have more acceleration. Well, I guess maybe theoretical top speed isn't affected, but the car in the inline six might not ever reach the top of its gearing. I never tried it on a straightaway that long because this car feels like it likes the corners. So I made sure I stuck to places where it could have some fun on the corners. But to demonstrate how much faster this is than the inline six going through here, we're hitting about 130 miles per hour, probably gonna hit 140 before we got to that wall. So it's quite a bit faster, and it's actually a decent amount harder to control. Like, I don't know if it's just it's that much more powerful, or if it's also, since this thing has racing slicks on it instead of semi-slicks, if it makes it a little bit more twitchy. And if you start to slide, it makes it a little bit harder to recover, possibly, because sometimes when you're using slicks, it makes the car grip a lot better. But when you do start to slide, you're sliding at much higher speeds, and you can't slide at as high of an angle before you spin out. And we got a long straightaway in front of us, so you know what we're gonna do? Big crash. This is gonna be about 150, 160 mile per hour crash right here. We're gonna use 100 times slow-mo on this thing so you can really see what happens here, because I think this car is just gonna go crunch. And there'll be very, very little left yet. Crunch. And I can't even tell what's a car anymore. So let's just go ahead and full speed this thing. Yeah, you're not going to see much because you just see a couple of parts flying around. If you told me that was a car, I would not believe you. So I'm kind of curious how this performs on the street. So let's just go ahead and head over to Jungle Rock Island at the hangar. And we're going to make a special version of the Apex just for street driving. So we're going to start with the Turbo V8 Racer. And we're going to do a couple of small changes to it. Now, one thing I forgot to mention earlier is the Turbo V8 Racer also has this front splitter right here for extra downforce, which I'm going to leave on because who cares if you bottom out as long as you look cool. What we are going to do, though, is we're going to go to the rear wheels and we're going to put on semi-slicks because slicks are not street legal. You need street legal tires when you're driving on the streets. So we'll say semi-slicks on both the front and rear. And then let's also go ahead and try out electronic stability control and traction control, because in real life, you almost never want to turn those off on the streets. The only time you want to do that is if you have really, really awful weather that's making the car not drive right, or you want to drive like an idiot and slide around the corners, which I might want to do, but I also want to see how aggressive the stability control is. And actually, I can really feel the stability control kicking in. It makes it almost impossible to spin this thing out, but it also makes it almost impossible to try to like drift it. Like right here, I'm flooring it the whole way, and I couldn't put the power down to go around that corner. We just kind of came to a stop before we could continue driving. So electronic stability control is the killer of fun, yes, but at least you're not going to crash your car, unless of course, you know, you just say, I'm going to go through this corner that I should only go at 60 miles per hour to 100 miles per hour and then just fly off the corner. Electronic stability control can only do so much. It can't predict the corner and slow down for you. This ain't no video game, this is real life, except this is a video game, but I mean, it can't do that in real life either, is what I'm saying by that. Like right here, going a little too fast through that corner, and electronic stability control almost pulled me off the road, because if I didn't have stability control, I could have kind of kicked it in a little tighter. Alright, so, I think that's enough of stability control, because all I'm doing is complaining about and saying, oh, I'm doing stability control, I don't need stability, I want to drift. So let's do that, we're going to say stability control off. And while we're here, you know what we're going to go ahead and do? We're going to say put the tow hitch on. Why? I don't know, because we have the option to. There it is, we got a tow hitch, so we can tow things with this, and we will in a minute. Oh, now we can slide. Now I floor it, and it's just, you're crooked the whole way as you accelerate. That's great. I feel like we're a lot faster, and this is very inappropriate for the streets to have electronic stability control off, but I don't care. I own these streets. I run these things. And I should have took a right there. I was like debating. You can tell I slowed down, like, which way do I want to go, which way do I want to go, and then I chose the other way after all. So actually, I do feel like it's easier to drive with the semi-slicks. I feel like you end up sliding a lot earlier so you can control the slide. It's not that it just had so much power in the Turbo V8 that it was hard to control, it's just the slicks made it a lot less forgiving, even though it made it technically faster if you were to drive good. Which isn't surprising to me. Flooring it. Gonna get this thing up to almost 100 miles per hour through the tunnel, but I'm scared. I'm scared. But we haven't bottomed out either, so you know what? This thing is very streetable, surprisingly, which I honestly did not expect. I expected it to be really terrible for the streets, bouncing all over the place and spinning out all the time, but we've been driving for a solid minute, which is, in YBR's world, really impressive that we haven't crashed yet. For the speeds we're going, super duper impressive. But we're gonna take that off the road before we crash it, and then we'll finish things off with a good old brutal slope leap of death combo. And of course, for brutal slope, you want the fastest version you could possibly get, no matter what, so we want the turbo V8 racer. And I don't know exactly how well it'll work, because we're gonna be topping out so fast because the gearing's gonna be the same as the other ones, but hopefully it'll be able to get down most of the hill before I have to worry about that. So I'll back it up a bit, and we are lined up, ready to go. And I actually kinda wanna do the jump with this thing, because it has such a big wing, it looks like it could fly, doesn't it? We'll do both. Just because we're here, we'll do both. So first off, the downhill, we're gonna get this thing up to probably 200 plus miles per hour, I think. Oh wow, the gearing is surprisingly long. Look at that, 20 miles per hour. We're not even fully topped. 7 gears. I never knew this had 7 gears. This thing has a ludicrous transmission in it right there, so we're actually still accelerating with the wheels and the power of gravity pulling me down the slope. That is impressive. What is more impressive, though, is how little car will be left in about 10 seconds or 0.1 seconds in real time. There we go. What car? I don't see a car there. That faint sound of an engine rumbling, you're just imagining that. That was never a car. Man, 200 mile per hour crashes. Cars are not designed for that. It just makes a little speck. That's all that's left. So I expect this to do really good in the jump then, because why wouldn't it? It goes fast, it has a big wing. I just gotta make sure I go in the right direction because I almost went down the tube on the left, the half tube, the half pipe, the half tube. That's a half pipe, YBR. Yes, yes, I know. We wanna go through the full pipe and then should be able to get up to about the same speed we did on the wall. Maybe even higher because we probably have better traction on this versus the grass. I don't know. Seems pretty close. I gotta make sure I'm near the center when we exit though so we don't have a rough exit. That was nice and smooth. And then let's see what happens when this thing hits the jump. I don't know what it's gonna do here. So we're gonna do full slow-mo and just watch. Ooh, car is look at the tires deforming at these speeds. Oh, they're popped. That's why they popped on the transition from the ramp to the grass, because it's a little sharp right there. And that's why they look so deformed. But the car itself is wiggling too. Look, you can really see it when we do 16 times slow-mo. The whole car is trying to shake itself apart, but somehow it held together to make it on the jump. And it even doing a flip. It's doing a flip and it sticks the landing. That was beautiful. That was really, truly amazing. I'm glad I did that jump. Anyways, let's go ahead and finish this off with Leap of Death, wherever it's hiding. I swear, I can never find it. Why? I don't expect this car to perform well here, though, because with racing slicks and a big turbo V8, I don't know if it'll be able to get any traction at all or not. We're gonna try it, though, flooring it, and, well, we are getting traction. I don't even need to feather the throttle or nothing. It just moves. Wow. I did come off the ramp a little bit sideways, but we were going fast. We were going at least 60 miles per hour. It's kind of hard to do it based on the speedometer because we were sliding all over the place, which means it had a little bit inaccurate readings, but based on how far we flew, that was definitely a 60 plus mile per hour jump. And then first impact is coming right now. You get to watch that. And then, well, there's not going to be much car to watch after that. Ooh, it might have got skewered a little bit and it might get stuck. Nope, it's bouncing off. We're good. And yeah, there's not much to look at anymore. The engines can still rev somehow by pure magic. And ooh, that rear end is like really jiggly right there after impact. Do you notice that? Anyways, we'll let this fall all the way to the end, and then that'll do it for this video. So until next time, this has been YBR, and I don't know what else to say because this thing is still falling. Remember to like, subscribe, and whatever. I don't know. I'm just trying to fill time, dude. I'll see you.